Hello everyone! Wherever and however you are watching, we are so thankful that you have chosen to spend the next 45 minutes with us. Everyone is welcome to be a part of our community of faith. If you're impacted by this broadcast, share it on your favorite social media platform because this might be the only church some might see, and we desire to reach as many people as possible with the love of Jesus. We also encourage you to partner with us in what we are doing in our community and around the world. Receive a link to give by texting the word EASY to 94000, or you may also give through the mail or on our website. Everything we do is because of your generosity, and we are so grateful that you partner with us in the work that we do. Lastly, and most importantly, we want to make sure you connect with God and others. The first way you can do that is by watching church at home right here and interacting with others on the chat and sending in prayer requests and testimonies. The second way is by worshiping with us in person at Newsong on any Sunday at 10 a.m. The third way is by joining a small group and gather with others online and in person. And the best way to get all details on all of this is to head over to our website. Oh, and make sure to subscribe to our emails and texts at the bottom of our homepage so you get our latest updates. Now the reason that you're with us today starts right now. We love you.
If you haven't yet, please grab something to eat and drink for this experience.
Following Christ's example, the church has historically used bread and wine or grape juice.
But for today's purpose, you can use whatever you have on hand.
If you have some bread, great. If not, work with what you have, whether it's a cookie, cracker, cornflake, or crouton.
And something to drink, some juice, coffee, tea, or maybe even tap water if that's what you have.
Now, if you're new to faith and church, communion might seem like an ancient ritual.
And it is. It was actually created by Jesus himself on the very night he was betrayed and arrested
to ultimately be crucified in his final meal with his first followers, sometimes called the Last Supper.
He took the bread and wine from the meal and led his disciples through the very first communion.
And for thousands of years since, the church has repeated this practice as a way of reminding and remaining connected to Christ's death and resurrection.
Just as Jesus encouraged us to do.
The bread and wine represent Christ's body and blood, which were sacrificed to ensure the forgiveness of sin and the restoration of all things.
But this meal is more than just a memorial. It's where we gather to be united to each other and to Christ, just like the dinner table in your home or at a family gathering. This is where we become family.
Where we draw strength and love from our Heavenly Father through our connection and commitment to each other.
It is a way of practicing our profound oneness as brothers and sisters in Christ.
So today, whether you're a regular participant, or even if this is your first time, if this is what you want to experience and express the life of God with the family of God, you're welcome to join and to participate with us right here and right now.
So right where you are, take whatever you've chosen to eat and remember Christ's body, which was broken for us. Let's eat.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only trust. Yeah.
night and in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Fall is to stand before the throne. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, just in his righteousness alone.
Today, as we come to the probably the most emotion-filled election week that we've ever experienced in our history, I want to just talk to you about being life and light to those around you. We're in a series called Masks, and today, I guess you would say, we're talking about the flesh mask, the mask that makes us ugly sometimes. And I want to give you three words today that stand in opposition of this mask. Pastor Chappie gave a wonderful message last Sunday about the political mask we wear. And I encourage you, please go back and listen to it. It is a wonderful dissertation of how to live in peace in the days we live. Today, I simply want to begin, like I said, with three single words to meditate upon that will keep you from wearing a mask you shouldn't wear in the coming week and in the weeks to come. And then I want to end with a prayer of unity over our country. I think it is so important in these days that if my people will humble themselves and pray, that good things happen. We love to complain and whine and worry, but do we ever just take a moment and pray about the things that bother us? And then we're going to do that at the end today. Now, I want to also mention that these thoughts are based on a prophetic word the president of our denomination, Randy Remington, gave last month to our Foursquare pastors. These words are... that these three words are character, civility, and Christ. Character. In the weeks to come, one word matters most. When people see us, when they see Jesus people, character matters most. Jesus gave a famous sermon, now famous, called the Sermon on the Mount. And in that sermon, he highlights what a Christian should look like and that they should have character. Jesus gives us something so much more powerful than politics to attract the world to the kingdom of heaven. He gives the word character. Jesus describes in the sermon how Christians are to influence the world best with two pictures, salt and light. When he talks about light in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14 through 16, he says, you, if you are a Christ person, if you are a Jesus follower, or if you are kingdom minded, you are the light of the world. You are not the bushel of the world. You are not the darkness of the world. You're the light. So act like it. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and then they put a bowl over it. No, you would never do that. Instead, they put it on a stand, a candle stick, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, my brothers and sisters, in the coming weeks, in an election year, in an election month, in an election week, let your light shine before others that they may see your ugliness. No, that they may see your good needs, good deeds. And then when they look at you, they'll glorify your Father in heaven because of the way your character shows itself. Character speaks louder than words and more effectively than anything that you disagree with and other people. Let character shine like a light on a hill. Don't let your salt lose its saltiness, he said earlier in that scripture. Your character, when it loses its saltiness, it can't season anything with good flavor. And we will need to season the world around us and shine our light all the more in the days to come. Character. The second word, civility. Here is the definition of civility if you don't understand the word. It says this: civility is defined as publicly displaying tact. Okay, this is must be talking about another country because I don't see that a lot here. Civility is defined as publicly displaying tact, moderation, and good manners toward people who are different than us or with whom we disagree. Let me explain that civility is more than just an expression of, oh, I want to be polite. I want to be publicly polite to you. That's what we have dissolved the word to mean in our day. We'll be polite to you to your face, but when we turn from you, we will talk about you and not show good manners. This kind of civility flows from a commitment to see others do good, to see others have blessing, to see others flourish. Because why? Because they deserve it? No. Because of what they stand up for? No. We want to see them flourish because God made them just like He made us. We all need Jesus. Just felt some snow fall from the roof that is still there. I think that civility is best observed in a church family, because immediately when we come into a church, or let's just say Newsong, we know that everyone coming there is coming for the same common reason. We have common ground there, and it's the most important common ground. It's Jesus. And automatically, we are not sizing each other up. We are not wondering what they believe. We know that they're here the same reason we're here. And we're committed to seeing each other grow in Jesus. We're committed to seeing each other continually be more and more like Christ. And it's rare that we actually are seeing our differences, because we are enamored or blessed by the things that we have in common. But we need to do this outside the church as well. Why should we treat other people with respect even when we hotly disagree with them? I ask you that. We do so, we practice civility with them, because every human is stamped with the image of God. Now, this is easier said than done, isn't it? Especially in a culture that we live, where we profit on demonizing people criticizing them, critiquing them, gossiping about them. We find joy, in fact, I don't think the word is joy, but we find enjoyment or happiness in putting others down. And certainly the media loves to do that more than anybody else, and they are our example. And that is not how we are to act. In Matthew 7, 1 through 5, Jesus is talking about judge others and you will be judged. And he teaches us that it is possible to observe the actions and words of someone you disagree with and not judge them. It's actually it's possible to do. It's the biblical thing to do. Withholding judgment, listen, it does not mean we don't contend for justice and righteousness and truth. It means that we ask the Lord to give us wisdom and humility before we react. Humility goes a long, long way. And I want to ask this question. What if this kind of character and civility was the public face of the church, the public face of Christianity in our days, that's what we were known for? Now, some people take that too far and they don't contend for justice and righteousness. They just love without asking the Holy Spirit to show them how to react. But what if this kind of character and civility was the public face of Christianity in America? Now, I said there was three words. The first was character, the second is civility, and the third also starts with C, and that is Christ. Christ. We always need to keep Christ at the center of our actions, our emotions, our thoughts, and our mind. Here's a great look at what it looks like to be Christ-like. Matthew chapter 22, we're going to look at Christ and see how he acted. Now, there were some people trying to catch him in a controversial situation, almost asking him, like, who are you voting for? He says, Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, "You hypocrites, you're trying to trap me. I know exactly what you're doing." They were asking him about taxes, and he said, "Show me the coin." So they brought the coin to him, and they thought, "We got him here." And he asked them, "Whose image is on the description or in the inscription?" And they proudly said, "Well, Caesar's is on the inscription." They were getting ready to catch him. And then he said to them, "Well, give back to Caesar what is Caesar." But here was his wisdom. Here was his wisdom. He thought before he spoke. He didn't just lash back. He used wisdom before he reacted. And he said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar, but give to God what is God." Jesus was asked about paying taxes, and in an attempt to manipulate him into declaring his political allegiance, they did this, and his questioners wanted to know if he favored the anti-tax party of the Pharisees or the pro-tax party of the Herodians. Jesus had a simple response: give to God what is God. He was saying this, and this is key for us in the day we are living in, the weeks to come. Don't give your ultimate authority. Don't give your ultimate loyalty, your heart, your passions, the very core of your being, to anything other than God. Give to God what is God's. How do you know for sure if you give your ultimate loyalty to Christ? Well, let me read a quote from author Tim Keller when he's talking about the climate we are in. He said, "When either party wins an election, a certain percentage of the losing side becomes agitated and fearful for the future. They have put the kind of hope in their political leaders that should be reserved for God." When we do this, we have not given God ultimate loyalty. Think about that. Three words: character, season this climate, my brothers and sisters, my Newsong family, and any others watching around the United States and world, with salt and light. Season, season, season. Civility. Don't just be polite. Be genuine, be authentic, be maskless, and want the best for others. Why? Because they're created in the image of God, just as you are. And thirdly, Christ. Where do you put your whole trust? Do you put it in money? Do you put it in chariots? Do you put it in politics? Do you put it in Jesus? Christ, put it in Jesus. Now we're going to take a moment and we're going to pray. And would you pray with me? Agree with me today. And then I'm going to ask you to reflect on what we just talked about. And make sure to whisper your own prayers in this next week. Don't just lash out. Don't just criticize. Don't just worry. Don't just complain. Every time you get ready to do this, take 1 minute and pray. A simple prayer. And watch as God brings peace to your heart. So Lord, right now we ask for 4 things. Help us live with character by being salt and light. Would you repeat that with me? Help us live with character by being salt and light. The second thing I want to pray is give us eyes to see people who are completely different from us with love. And Lord, we ask that you would truly bless these people. Help us to be able to ask, pray blessing upon them. And Lord, I pray for our interactions with them, that they are filled with love. Thirdly, we ask for wisdom and care in our conversations over the next few weeks with those we agree with and those we disagree with. And help us keep Christ at the center. In other words, help us keep our loyalty and our trust in Christ, not in a news group, not in the media, not in what we read, not in what we see, not in a politician. Help us keep our loyalty to Christ. I am so thankful that Christ, when we do this, our lives will see peace. And Lord, finally, we pray for a spirit of national unity. Now, this isn't for a certain political party. This is a prayer for national unity. Lord, I pray that you would heal our fractures that exist between generations of people. Heal those fractures. Heal the fractures between cultures, because we are a melting pot of all cultures in our country. Help us to have unity amongst our cultures. Help us to have unity amongst our ethnicities. And Lord, let us have even unity amongst men and women. Lord, as only you can, bring unity to our country and help us facilitate it and bring it to pass. We love you. We give our full allegiance to you. We love our country. We love our democratic system. But most importantly, we love you, and we are kingdom people, and we are not of this world. And we look forward to the day that we are together in heaven. In Jesus' name, everybody said amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed day.
Thanks for joining us for Church at Home. We all need connection now more than ever before, so here are 3 reminders for staying connected. If you'd like to join a virtual or in-person small group, or join us for our in-person Sunday service, text the word connect to the number below. If you would like prayer, text the word prayer to the number below, and our team will pray for you. And if desired, we'll also reach out and see how we can support you. And finally, if you made a new commitment to Jesus today, text the word yes to the number below, and we will send you some encouraging resources. See you next time. Have a blessed week.
Welcome, may I have your attention. Pull up a seat, begin the lesson. Ba-da-dum, let's go. Right. I got that. You got that.